Predictor is a term that you have heard a lot. It's a little bit of a misnomer, so it's not really about how big your data is that makes it the opportunity. The thing that makes an opportunity is that these several factors have come together which allow much more interesting use of analytics and much more powerful analytics. So there's a lot more raw data about, both from things like computer systems, which is why lots of these applications originated in the internet industry, but also increasingly from physical things like mobile phones, GPS sensors, Internet of Things, deployment of technology, very broadly. It means there's a lot of raw data available which can be turned to lots of different purposes. So it used to be that data was a very, very structured thing. We thought very much in terms of data warehouses and defining the schema and sticking to that schema forever. We now think much more in terms of there's a large pool of data available. It's kind of messy, but we accept that, and we define some pipelines that turn them into a structure that's good for now. So the term you hear a lot is late finding schema, meaning that you have a schema for now, you apply it as late as humanly possible, and you define the pipeline that turns the raw data into the right schema. You know that tomorrow you might change your mind about what that schema should be. You might have to rebake everything in your data sources. That's okay, because you've got lots of servers, they're very cheap to run, you've got distributed systems, so you don't really care that you have to reinvent the wheel every so often, because it's just a long process again. The second thing that's really important is the rise of real-time and near-real-time processing of that data. So until a few years ago, it was really quite eye-wateringly expensive to do anything in anything approaching real-time. Now, thanks to better connectivity, but also things like Kafka, for example, which is open source tech that's good for messaging queues, you can actually handle data much more rapidly in a much more realistic way. And again, it's the cost element which is the really important thing. So, the finance industry has been doing real time for quite a while, but it was very, very costly, and now it's much less so. And then finally, you've got technologies to do all of this. So, flexible and cost-effective open source technologies which let you process very large amounts of data, generally with sort of unlimited headroom, because the nature of processing data with clusters of servers means you'll always add another server into the cluster to keep expanding, which leads to a shift in thinking about what problems you might address. So whereas previously you had quite hard upper limits on the amount of data you could process or what you could do, now it's no big deal. You just add another server if your cluster's creaking a bit at the seams, which really makes things much more interesting than an analytical point of view, because you don't need to know ahead of time how you're going to meet. You spin up and spin down very quickly. For our part, particularly when the company was starting out, we made really heavy use of things like spotting instances on Amazon as well. So if you're willing to put in a bit of extra work, it can be very cheap, even cheaper, to get power available. If you're willing to do it at times that are less convenient or on the funny side of servers in different ways, you can really do whatever you like in terms of scale. So that's what we do. We run a company which offers and manages that kind of technology. We have a core platform which we reuse with all our clients, but that's open sourced as well. It's basically glueing together things like Spark, Kafka, different big data technologies that apply to these kinds of problems. And that is applied to different types of clients' issues, always with an element of being very big or very complex that needs to be brought to bear on some real business problem. And it turns out, happily for us, that quite a lot of different people need that sort of thing. We have some straightforward commercial clients, so people like AO Media and Virgin Media, who've just got that classic, I've got lots of data, I'm not sure it needs to be in, but I just need to apply the technology to put everything together. We also have what we consider some more interesting and important for the world clients, so people like Northern Publishing, who are a science publisher, people like the Energy Savings Trust, who try and help the UK hit its energy savings targets, and people like Nesta, who are UK agency that's trying to find new applications of technology. So a real mishmash of clients, but with a bias towards the ones who we think are trying to do something new in the world and who can be helped by having this technology push. So I talked about what I meant by big data. really, more importantly to most of our clients, they want to know about the data science side of things, and then they'll be thinking about things like, should I hire a data scientist? How do I build out this capability? What is it that I need? And this is quite an odd combination of skills that I think you need to be a good data scientist. And it's really these three things, and all of these three have to be present in some mix in a good data scientist, or at least a good data science team. They need to be across different bodies as long as those brains collaborate really, really well. So it's three things really, sexed up statistics, so both the old standard statistics and more scalable methods like the sort of neural nets and things that we see.
Well, I'm watching the video.
The ability to code, so the ability to apply those statistics at scale, turn them into production systems and run those systems in a reliable way. And having a business understanding to see how to fit those things together and apply them to business problems. So again, as I said, much of the use of data, particularly the front industries we work with, is really experimental. So it's really getting started, trying things out, some things work, some things don't. And your reference point for whether it's working is always, has it had an impact on the business? Do I understand how this would work in the business? Will this change things? What do I need to know? So you need all those three pieces together. And then you use techniques, which are common to data science, which some of you will consider really simple, some of you may not. Things like clustering. So this is an example of unsupervised machine learning. Meaning you don't have a preordained answer, so you don't have a particular thing that you're trying to predict or target to answer. Clustering is a way of finding patterns in populations of people, of things, and trying to find sensible segments to split them into. It is computationally fairly intensive, but mathematically fairly simple. If you've not tried it before, you might want to try something like k-means clustering, is the classic common method to use. And it's a really good way to just get started in describing a big data set and making sense of it as a population. And the key big thing is that if you've got a very big population, it's much easier to start to pick out clusters. And you throw a lot of servers at it, then you'll find those clusters quite quickly. So this is an interesting thing, so having some power behind it. And the classic government application of clustering is things like classification. So this is something that government organisations use a fair bit to talk in broad terms about the characteristics of different areas. This was based on the 2011 census, taking the characteristics of people who lived in each of these areas, chucking them all in the pot, and then seeing what natural segments they fell into. In this case, they've come up with 8 segments. Can't read all the titles, but going from things like hard-pressed living on the right, so presumably these were people who had challenges of various kinds, through to the rural residents on the left. So they were just seeing what dimensions of the data seemed to categorise each of these clusters that naturally came out, and then turn that into a nice colour-coded thing that lets you talk about the groups in a particular way. So it's applying data and lots of processing to call out something that's actually quite practically useful. And another approach which is suddenly coming up people's radar a lot is text analysis. Again, this is a nice mix of stats and programming and thinking about business. Text is not usually thought of as a data source. It's pretty disregarded because it looks messy, it doesn't appear to have much structure to it. But in fact, by applying some machine learning techniques, generally unsupervised techniques, you can unlock quite a lot of structure quite quickly. So the thing that people naturally go to with text mining is often sentiment analysis. So sentiment analysis of tweets being the obvious case that is a good sort of toy case to work on. The problem with that is that it's hard to see many applications for sentiment other than sort of seeing what people are saying about your brand or product. And sentiment is actually really, really hard to get right, particularly in the UK where people are sarcastic. It's actually quite a tricky emotional problem. However, there are some problems that are much, much easier to solve if you have a bunch of text. For example, topic finding on text. So throwing a computer at a bunch of text saying, what do these different documents seem to be about? Oops, I think I lost my presentation. That's not helpful. Excuse me one second. So text analysis, I was saying, there are hard problems like sentiment analysis. There are also some very easy problems like topic finding. So a topic in text analysis terms is just a cluster of words that seems to occur often across documents. Usually you'll find if you do an actual topic, unsupervised topic finding, you'll start to find some clusters of words that actually do have a sensible human meaning behind them. So you get some cluster of words that you get clusters of words that are fairly mundane, like things that appear in footnotes together, but then you also get clusters of words that actually reflect subjects in the text corpus that you're looking at. And that can provide a really good way to just initially classify some documents and see what they seem to be about. I'll talk a little bit more about a case of that later. Again, if you're just starting to get into this, then looking at things like the LDA method of topic finding is quite a quick way in. You can basically throw it at most bits of text and you'll get a fairly okay result and then fine tune from there. If you want to get more sophisticated, then things like Word2Vec, which Google have come up with recently, is getting more sophisticated and more semantic in its meaning. So there are lots of different libraries which are already pretty good, which you can put over a Z text pretty quickly. The main challenge, in fact, is tidying up the corpus enough to be machine readable, stripping out bump, for example, if you're using PDFs, stripping out all the gunk that comes at the top and bottoms of pages and PDFs, and that takes a lot more work than the actual analytical piece. So all of these things go together. Text. And all of these things go together in a sort of umbrella case, really, of doing data science, which is doing predictive modelling. So this is the sort of standard supervised learning thing that you tend to do with all these materials once you've got them together. Supervised learning meaning that there is some correct answer which you're trying to get the computer to get to. And there are multiple technical approaches to doing it. Ooh, something perished going to the web, isn't it? The types of predictions you might want to make are in a commercial context, things like will a particular customer want a particular product, so should I offer it to them? Wow, these words are all in the wrong order. Yeah. Okay, something very strange has happened to this slide. That is not what that slide is meant to say. I kill it for me because it's really confusing me. I have to think now what my examples were. So in a commercial context, it's about a particular customer wanting a particular product, and that helps you make a commercial decision about whether to show it to them. In the Google case, for example, they only have at the most 3 ad slots on the page that they want to use. They have to decide what is the most likely thing that you are going to click on when you search on Google, or should they show you any ads at all? So they're using predictive modeling to do that. In something like a safety case, fire brigades use data to try and work out which buildings are most likely to catch fire, so where they should focus their preventative efforts, because they don't have many people who can go around and try and look for fire risk. It's quite an expensive thing, so they want to really focus in on the highest risk buildings. And then in something like a social care case, social workers get huge amounts of inbound referrals talking about children who may or may not be at some risk of harm. They don't have enough social workers to go and do a really in-depth review of every single one. So again, using predictive approaches based on the data that you have at the time just helps you float the likely highest risk things to the top. Now, none of these approaches is totally infallible. It's based on how things panned out in the past in similar cases. But it really helps to just prioritise in a case of limited resources, whether that's limited ad slots on a page, limited fire inspectors to go around the buildings, limited social workers to go and check the children are okay. So all of these are ways of focusing attention or resources on the right thing. And there are many, many techniques for doing this. There are some quite common statistical ones like logistic and linear regression. These are the sort of granddaddy techniques that everybody uses over small and large data. But there are more and more sophisticated machine learning techniques which take advantage of the cheapness of server power. So looking at things like neural networks, which with the Google TensorFlow libraries, which came out last year, is actually much more accessible. You can just do less thinking and more throwing of servers at it, basically. And that can also lead to some interesting results. That's where you do need the statistics part as well as the programming part, because as a statistician, you need to know what holes can you fall down if you just throw lots of computers at something. But sometimes throwing lots of computers at it can be the right answer. So it's an interesting trade-off. And then putting all these together, I said that in the case of things like big enterprises like Google or government, where you've got limited resources, you can use these techniques to focus attention on resources on the most important things. You can also use it to surveil whole systems and work out what's anomalous and what these deal with. So once you have a bunch of data together, you have some prediction of how things should be, you can start to look at where things are not how they should be. And again, that's used across multiple cases. So in a government case, it can be used to find things which seem unusually risky, which require attention. It's also used very much in things like fraud detection and banking. So in contexts where you expect most things to be normal and some things to be unusual, and you want to catch and squash the unusual things quickly, the anomaly detection approaches can be really, really important. So I've run through a few examples of the sort of theoretical techniques. I'm going to talk about a couple of real projects, and then I think we'll go through a couple of other things about projects and then go to some Q&A. So, just wanting to talk about some realistic situations. So this is an example of some work with ARIC, which is an engineering firm. Their clients have the interesting problem of owning large, expensive assets which can kill people if they go wrong. So, to make sure that doesn't happen, the traditional method is to send out a lot of engineers to do routine inspections and maintenance and hit things with spanners and make sure they're all okay. And that is indeed a very fine way of making sure everything's okay, but it's very expensive. So ARIC's clients and people like them are starting to fit out those physical assets with sensors which detect just what's going on those assets in terms of movement, vibration, tilt, water, all these other things. And the collection of data from those contexts lets you take a predictive approach. In the same way as I talked about predicting, for example, based on internet data, you can now predict based on physical situation data what things are likely to fail. The reason that is interesting is that it lets you focus those expensive resources on the right problem. So you could either reduce risk even further by keeping the same amount of engineers circulating and using risk-based modelling to put those engineers in front of the problems which seem highest risk today. Or you can flip it around and say, I want to keep the same risk level as when they were doing regular circular maintenance and just send them out less often, so reduce cost. Either way, there's either a reduction in risk or reduction in cost through increased information. This is quite a new type of application because sensors have only recently become reliable and cheap enough for it to be sensible to have a crack at this kind of thing. But I think over the next couple of years this is going to be a very, very big field. There's now apparently a new field called prop tech, property technology, which has a lot of very, very niche applications of these kind of things. It's an emergent field, but it's looking very, very strong. I've lost some words after this one, but I am having a bad technology day. Sorry. I said I'd talk about a real example of text analysis, and this is quite an interesting one from DEFRA, which is in charge of animal health. They have to look after the health of all the livestock in the UK. That is quite a challenging business because there's a lot of livestock. You don't have an awful lot of information about them. They die in all sorts of interesting and unusual ways, some of which are likely to repeat and some of which aren't. That's a bit of a problem when you're trying to spot the next epidemic coming up. So with DEFRA, we worked on a proof of concept to use the post-mortem reports that they get in to start to get early warning of new issues. So one of their key data sources is post-mortem sent in by vets who find a dead animal in unusual circumstances. If the local vet thinks it's sufficiently interesting, they will write up a post-mortem and send it to DEFRA. DEFRA's vets in their central team are overwhelmed by such reports. It is difficult for them to have their eye on the ball on every small trend that comes up in every such report. So we've worked with them to use text mining and that topic detection method that I talked about earlier to start to monitor over time when there are new topics that start to pop up in time or a particular time or a particular place. So the geographic or time-based emergence of something new, which then lets those vets focus their attention on that new thing. So in this case, when it finds a new topic, it extracts a few paragraphs with examples of that topic, pops it up to a vet, and then they can have a look and see if they're concerned or if they actually think that's mundane and I know about it already. So again, it's an example of just using text as a data source and getting the computers to do the legwork on supporting human tasks in an anomaly detection kind of way. The last one I wanted to mention is this work for Energy Savings Trust. And this might be interesting to product for the Turkey's money. This is a Cassandra-based system, so it's more of a time series database. And you can find the code for it on our GitHub repository under Hecuba if you want to have a look. Energy Savings Trust is an organisation which is supposed to help the UK hit its carbon savings targets. One of the main levers they have to do that is to try and get homes be more energy efficient by introducing insulation, introducing new boilers, and all sorts of new improvements which might make them better from an energy perspective. One of the problems with that is that homes don't follow the physics models, so there's a good theoretical model of how insulation ought to work in a house. That's pretty well understood, the physics is stable, everyone knows that. However, when houses have people in them, those people mess up the physics really badly. So they do things like open windows when they're not supposed to, they take showers at unpredictable times of day, which messes up your lovely water heating thing that keeps water hot for just the right amount of time. Sometimes they live in cold places, sometimes they live in hot places, sometimes it's damp. It's all sorts of variables which just aren't accounted for in a theoretical model. So one of the ways EST tries to get a handle on this is have lots of test homes with various technologies fitted, like different types of boiler or insulation. And they know a bit about the people who live in those homes, and they fit them out with a lot of sensors that tell them both the energy consumption minute by minute, but also things like the comfort level inside the house. So what's the temperature? Is it humid or cool? Is there high CO2 level, which makes it feel stuffy? What's the temperature inside and outside? So what circumstances is that house dealing with? And pulling in data from things like Met Office as well to validate that. This lets them get a handle on what the patterns are and what things are likely to scale and not scale. Really, the reason I've included this example is to show that it's very cheap to run high-scale systems now. So this now runs on less than 1,000 a month, and it's got a few billion data points going in. So it's got quite a few thousand sensors catching data every minute and putting it in here. But as long as you design the system sensibly and it's a decent distributed system, it's very, very cheap. And that means that you no longer have to think about data quantity as a constraint. You just have to think about doing a sensible design so that you don't spend crazy money, but that's fine as long as you're intelligent about how you design the technical side. And then it's just open to using this data in whatever way you find most interesting. So I'm going to skip over all of this. And very briefly, just talk about some lessons that we've learned over the past few years of what helps clients' data projects to succeed. So I think most of you are people who will be serving clients with these projects. So the lessons are less for you and more for clients, but they're really signals worth watching out for, because certainly for us some of these have been quite hard-won signals to learn about. The positive factors we found that are if clients are comfortable with the possibility of failure, whether they call it failure or not, they're comfortable with the possibility that everything is not awesome after the first iteration of something. Is really important to things working, because experiments fail, experiments work. You shouldn't have to stop entirely if the first experiment doesn't go well. Having time boxes, sprints, checkpoints, whatever you call them, basically hard constraints on how far you're going to go before you review progress and decide what to do next.
with one of the options including stop this entirely. So you have to have cards on the table each time box to see what you should do next. We always say invest in the people more than in the technologies. So we have some clients who sort of seen a beautiful demo from a very big, usually Silicon Valley firm, and they're just, you know, blown away by how cool it looks. Those cool demos are not necessarily going to be the solution. In fact, they're pretty much never the solution. There is no such thing as a perfect general purpose data science thing, because it's really about the people who are steering the particular solution for your particular data problem. So we always say just invest in the people, whether that's external people, whether that's your own staff. That's much more of a priority than the specific technology choice. And you've got to have a business goal. So for our part, this is really the key bit of getting started on any project, is defining the terms of what you're trying to do and making sure it really connects to what the senior people in the business need. So they've got to care about the results of this system, otherwise it will just peter out and people will say, well, we've tried experimenting with data, nothing else, so I'm not going to bother anymore. And the converse to all of this is, some of you probably lived through these, getting the data clean and perfect first, one source of truth, golden record. There are many names for this. If you try and do that before you do anything experimental with analytics, you will never get to the experimental analytics, because it's so hard to define what clean and perfect is. It's such a mammoth effort. By the time you get to the end of it, you have to start again. It's like the fourth bridge. And so you have to accept working with imperfect data and using that first part of imperfect data as a feedback loop to know how data needs to be improved. Clients, hopefully not you guys actually, but clients will often be paralysed by technology options. So we'll be saying, well, I've surveyed the market, there are 30 possible systems or pieces of kit or open source libraries that could do this, and I need to know which is the best one to choose. The truth is there's often no single best one. There might be quite a few decent options, and you have to move forward. You have to not let yourself get paralysed by that. The wish for insight without having a question. Again, this is a classic senior person thing. You know, CEO says, I've heard you do data things, tell me something insightful. Insightful is just relative to their context, so you always have to bring it back to what their context is and what insight would be for them. And then just the inability to productionize. So this has killed many a good proof of concept. Perfectly good predictive thing, works technically very nicely, process is great, really good performance. But somebody in the business needs it not to happen for their own reasons, whether it's it contradicts something they've committed to, it potentially reduces the size of their team, many other really mundane but very real reasons why things get stopped. And then the failure, which is more within our control generally, is communication gaps between the business need, the tech build, and the data scientists. So getting those all talking really closely is just absolutely critical to getting anywhere with this data. So, this computer does not like me. Okay, there. Last slide, and then I'm going to give up on this. So, the lessons that we've learned, that we actually now approach as golden rules when we're writing proposals for clients and put this in as our approach. We assume that you will do this, we assume that we are doing this and you will support this, is always make sure it's an important business problem, always make sure there is either relevant raw data available or build in stage one to the project, which is find out what the relevant raw data is and stop if not, and know why they need a solution. So what is the point of this for them? Is it money, is it time, is it risk reduction, is it something else? Get the team together. In our case, we generally contribute the data science and tech, and they generally contribute the business understanding. Those people have to get on and communicate and talk a lot. That's sometimes a surprise to clients, because they expect us to go away, do some magic, and come back with all the answers. And the reality of analytics and data science is it's quite a messy and interactive process, and feeds a lot, actually, off experts' own knowledge, as well as things that you can find in the data without expertise. And then you make sure you've got a time box, constrained amount of time resources to have a go.
point at which you plan to pause a review and the concept up front that the first attempt may not work and the ability to cope if it does. So those are our lessons learned on how to do this. I see it's nearly 22 already, so I'm going to pause there and do some questions or discussion, hopefully. Everyone's feeling brave.
Hi, I work with web analytics, so I do a lot with Google Analytics and stuff like that. I have come to it from a finance point of view, so lots of Excel, lots of spreadsheet analysis. Where do you recommend I start with getting more into the coding side?
Do you code at all at the moment?
I've got kind of basics and stuff like JavaScript, HTML, Python, but I haven't really
So if you're already comfortable with Python, I would start there because actually there are lots of really good data science libraries in Python, and it scales okay. If you're really into stats, then R can be a good place to start, but as a programming language, it's horrible. It's just statistically really powerful. Python is a brilliant compromise language for that kind of thing. Scikit-learn, Python's a really good library. Cool. To poke around, you'll find loads of code examples as well, so you can still open up. Scikit-learn, scikit-learn.
Do you ever kind of productionize R in kind of web applications, and if so, kind of what experience
do you
have?
Do we productionize R?
Yeah.
I said I don't write that much code. The only code I really write is R, and the team always want to kill me when I do it.
Okay, I'm an R person.
Yeah, so they always tell me it's not a proper language, it doesn't scale, what are you doing? Translate all this. You can do web application, but it is kind of clunky, I have to confess. So things like Shiny are quite good for setting stuff up, but it's not great, to be honest. You kind of have to shift to Python, or our team actually use Clojure, which is a functional language, but it's kind of niche, unless it's your kind of thing. But Python is probably the thing that you want to get your arms around, really.
Would you have to know many other ones other than SQL?
So SQL will paint you into a bit of a corner, is the thing. So SQL is great when the data is already structured, but it doesn't give you that many exploratory tools because you require the data to already be tabular and sensible in that sense. So you kind of need a general purpose language like Python or R or something like that to get much further, annoyingly. If you're looking at Python, then IPython notebooks are a nice way to learn as well. So these are sort of interleaved code and explanation of what the code is doing. A lot of people publish their notebooks, and those are good learning examples to get your head around what it's doing.
Fran,
yeah.
How important is it to have that business knowledge or that domain knowledge applied to the data? Because always with the sort of big data space, business managers, senior officials, always have this idea that you just throw a load of data at it, get some smart people having a look at it, we'll come out with a load of insight really easily.
Yeah.
I get the impression what you just said is you need to have a mental model of how the business operates, what the business problem is you're trying to solve, and a bit of expertise about how the processes in that business work to make sense of the data that you're actually looking at.
It certainly makes things an awful lot easier. I mean, you certainly need to know the business problem, otherwise you know, things that I find interesting and insightful, the client may not find at all interesting and insightful. So at least if I've got a problem statement, that's something to start with. And then you can shortcut an awful lot of messing about if you have someone on client side who doesn't need to be senior, but needs to just have been around and seen some things. And if you're trying to, for example, do a predictive process, you say, well, if you were doing this as a person, let's look at this case together. Which things there do you pick out as interesting and unusual? Or what makes you go, oh, that one looks risky? And that just lets you shortcut an awful lot of the feature construction process when you're dealing with messy data. You can get around it by just chucking a lot of firepower at it. But it's quicker and neater to get some human assistance in shortcutting.
And presumably you get yourselves into the situations where the client doesn't really know what the correct business question is.
Yeah.
So you need to do some work to come up with some things that help them understand the question they should be asking.
Definitely very iterative. Like we always try and make sure we've got something to start with, which is at least if you're doing a framed question, but But then if they're like, don't know if that's it, then you might just spend a week or two, show them what you've got, and then they'll go, oh, now I see what you're doing,
yeah.
Now I can frame much more clearly what I want. In the same way as other sort of agile software development, basically, you build a bit of it, and they go, oh, now I see it, I can actually tell you that I need to reprioritize this thing and move this feature out and move this feature in. So it's that education piece is quite important.
The mantra I tend to use with people is, you know, insight is a good answer to a good business question.
Yeah.
Trouble is, you have neither of those at the start of that journey, so you have to go through that iterative process.
Yeah, so there's a bit of sort of jiggling about to get all the pieces together before you start to really, really roll with those things.
Question. Given you might be dealing with sensitive information, especially if you're dealing with business, it might hold sensitive information. And all this is being processed, you mentioned computing power, should it all processed in a cloud environment that's scalable. How do you protect that information? Do you anonymize it before you process, or do you have to process the raw data, and how do you then protect it to make sure it's not accessible?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Sorry, so the question was, we probably have to deal with personal data quite often. We're doing it in a cloud environment. How do we handle that aspect of it? So the answer varies with context. In a commercial context, it's generally okay to do it with good security measures, so keeping the data in the EU. So as long as you're using one of the we use AWS as the web services a lot, so we keep it in the EU locations, and we use strong security and encryption. Obviously, avoid having personal data where we can. Often it's much the quickest route to keep the personal data and just ditch it once we've joined data sets, for example. So just have it in flight in the system and then drop it as soon as we can. In a government context, it's much more complex because although the law is the same, government is much more hesitant about use of personal data. So it's just a lot slower. We generally just try to avoid touching personal data at all in that case. So anonymize or pseudonymize the source first before we touch it. Generally, pseudonymize is a good compromise. So if someone was very, very determined to re-identify someone, they could, but then also there's security layers to stop them even seeing the data. So that's normally the compromise solution. And from a contractual point of view, we're usually a data processor rather than a data controller. Which means that we are following the instructions of our client to do things, and we're running it by them whenever we do something like that.
So with that in mind, with the GDPR coming in, how do you think that's, because I'm in a similar field, how do you think that's going to affect analytics? Because you can't get approval from a client.
Yeah.
To use their data for processes you don't know yet, because you're going to find interesting patterns.
I know.
That's the whole point.
I know. Don't know.
Yeah.
I think we need some case law before we really know how it's going to work. I've got a nasty feeling that it's going to be commercial people continually very gung-ho with it and just doing whatever they want and just waiting to see if they get told off, while government will sort of even more retract from doing much with data. I hope that's not the case, but I've got a nasty feeling that might be.
Particularly with the view of big data lakes, just piling in, and then
you
can get it back out.
You can't pre-define the use case often, so
and also someone can insist you delete all of their data and then you can prove that you have.
Yes,
if you've got multi-sharded data sets where it will be eventually consistent.
Yeah, I mean, I've not seen any sensible technical answer to how that's even possible, frankly.
Oh, well, we've got 15 months.
That is definitely a concern, particularly with sort of data lake approaches. How do we have that data in a data lake? You have to be able to delete evidence of that deletion, because, as you said, sharded. So eventually, it's probably not a good enough answer under that legislation.
No, it's about 48 hours.
Is that the time limit?
Yeah. Oh, they could only fine you 2% of your group turnover, so it's okay.
It's right for people like us, really small. Yeah, you'd be a bit more upset if you're the
big guys. Yeah, but like you were saying about the data processing and data guardians, it goes all the way through the chain, so it doesn't matter who screws up, it doesn't matter who leaves the file on a tube train, you all get it.
Well, files on tube trains, that's we're not going to do that.
No, that's true.
We can protect
against
that quite easily. It's the unknown breach, it's the accidental key exposure, it's that stuff that is that is the stuff that gives me cold sweats about touching personal data, which is why we'd rather not, if we can avoid it. Sometimes you can't avoid it to solve the business question.
The other trouble we run into in business environments is people that are asking questions that want the insight and the answers usually ask that question and say, and can you have that on my desk by 5 o'clock tonight? Now the process that you describe feels iterative,
yes.
Quite a bit of a journey.
Yes.
How do you square the circle between dealing with a business who's quite demanding and a process that is actually quite involving?
I mean, the process can get quicker over time. So I'm talking about a process of your first go at something. And as you get more of a handle on the data, you know, add-on questions become easier and quicker. And potentially, you know, if they do ask the question in a way that's friendly, say, actually, I've got that data sorted already, I can just do it. That's fine. But generally, yeah, 5 o'clock tonight is not very realistic for something sophisticated. And they kind of have to get a little bit used to that.
So you have to teach them how to understand the data. Sort of
start
the process of
yeah, to some extent, and you have to think about how do I reward them as early as this is sort of training process almost. Like how do I give them a reward as early as possible for being patient and talking to me?
Yeah.
Like something that solves a bit of their problem, with the promise of going away to do a bit more, and you know the incentive that if this data set can be shared, in that could become more accurate. And sort of pushing through that way, but. Yeah, there has to be something in it for them quite early on, otherwise people will just think of just data science stuff, it's all just people being wrapped up and full of their importance and it's not really relevant.
Once you deliver the solution, do you usually have an ongoing relationship with the client or do you skill somebody up to be able to take it forward?
It varies. So because our systems are open source, usually our clients have at least the eventual plan to take it over themselves. Probably about half the time we'll start off running the system for them. About half the time immediately there's a POC done, either they don't want to take it further or they want to do it themselves. In which case we'll just coach and work with them to make sure it's handed over in a sensible way. But yeah, it varies on the maturity of the organisation and who they've got in-house, whether it makes sense for them to take it on immediately or whether they say actually I want to get the benefits of this for a while and make sure it's worthwhile investing and then build out a team. It's quite deep technical stuff running these sorts of systems, so you've got to be quite confident it's worthwhile hiring people to do it. So you need to prove that first.
How about self-service type activities, though, for the analysts to be able to do it themselves?
In terms of
rather than having to program it, or yeah, how would you see that?
I'm quite sceptical of things that promise you don't need stats. You don't need data science people, you don't need stats people anymore. Just, you know, anyone can do this machine learning thing. Because I think there are just so many pitfalls if you don't understand what you're doing and you don't understand the context of your data and the particular problem you're solving. So I'm quite wary of total self-service. I think if you have a known type of problem that repeats quite a lot, you can build a self-service sort of module or whatever to sort that problem. But I don't think there's a completely general purpose, machine learning, self-service, don't need any specialists anymore solution. Just as well because they're out of the job, but I really, really, like honestly, if I you know take personal interest out of it, I really don't think that is a possible thing. Because there's so much human and creative contextual stuff in it that I don't think you can separate.
How do you draw the line between small data and big data projects? I'm starting a project analysing data.
Yeah.
How do I know that I need to use a spreadsheet? Spreadsheets are going to cope with this, or then
yeah.
Go to SQL, that's not going to cope, and then move to a big data model.
I'd have to think about what you need for the project. So if you can solve it quickly with a spreadsheet, then do it. If you need it to live for a longer time, then I'd at least think of writing it in a programming language, because then at least you've got some history and some repeatability. And then if that starts to not work on your laptop, then you've got to start to think about big data and
so again, it's that iterative thing, you start small and then you work through it and you get to a point where you realise you can't get further. So you're not from the outset, you wouldn't think from the outset I need to use a big data solution to solve this problem.
Not unless you know the data is big and you just know you're going to need it. I mean, it's always use the simplest tool possible for what you need. Because we're big data specialists, we generally get brought in at a point where people have gone, oh bloody hell, I've tried spreadsheet, I've tried SQL, it's not working, and then we'll come in and help with that problem. But you don't have to use the big tools from the off. I mean, they're quite complicated. If you're comfortable coding, it's generally sensible to start coding in some general language, because then it's much calmer to transition from like a Python script to a Python script calling a Hadoop cluster, than from a spreadsheet to a Python script calling a Hadoop cluster. There's just fewer steps of thought to go through. And actually, spreadsheets are horrendous for introducing error as well, because they're so hard to audit, and the style of them is so personal to the person writing them. There's something called EU SPRIG, which is the EU Spreadsheets Risk Information Group or something, which has some hilarious and awful horror stories of things that have happened because of spreadsheets trying to do things that are too complicated with spreadsheets, which is worth a look if you've ever had those moments. Hello.
A lot of what you've described seems to me to have a lot of open-ended situations. How do you go about pricing these projects in a way, or is it just all time based?
Through some painful lessons. So generally, I might even have a slide on here actually. So this sort of thing, we found it's really important to have stages and have breaks between stages. So in terms of pricing, we can usually basically time box scoping and discovery, so you can figure out how long you intend to spend on it, and you can say firmly how much that will cost to deal with the problem, so you can get the price of that, and then tell the client when we get to the end of this we will be able to answer those questions, and we will be able to tell you whether it makes sense to proceed to building something. So you sort of price the first bit, and then you build or do a POC. But by then you know a lot more about data, you know a lot more about the problem, so you can price it more confidently. We often either do a fixed price thing and say the scope may vary, but we price it so that we're confident we can do something useful. Or we might provide a price range if the client is a bit more comfortable with that, fix the scope. So it's definitely about having stages and breakpoints where you can build your knowledge and your confidence about time ranges. When we started out, we didn't put in those breakpoints, and we had some very painful learning experiences. Like, we have not yet delivered the system that we need to deliver, so we just have to keep going until we're done. When you're doing that on fixed price, you're losing a lot of money. It's a not very surprising lesson. So, we now are quite strict about phasing things.
You mentioned before about sentiment analysis. Specific problem. Is that a forever problem, or is that a now problem?
Oh, I'm sure it's a now problem. I mean, I think anything where, you know, an intelligent child can learn to detect sarcasm, a computer will learn to detect sarcasm. So that's usually the sort of sensible test of what will we eventually teach a computer to do. Is, you know, a smart child or a not very bright intern could do this with this instruction, then the computer will do it. Things which are much more contextual and personal are much harder to
do. Is there a specific problem you find particularly interesting, or you found over the years, or that's been challenging, or you let go, or do they tend to be repeatable when you go to the
That sort of speaks to the question about pricing, actually. We have a bad habit of always wanting novel problems and more interesting new things, which doesn't do wonders for profit margins, but does make life very interesting. I really think text mining is interesting and important, even though it's statistically not the most fancy thing. There's so much text data, and there's so much value locked into it, that really could be and should be released and could make a lot of difference. So that's something that I find really interesting and keep coming back to. With clients particularly, because they just don't see it, and they have these huge opportunities that they don't see. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.